It's been a long week. Fred, why has it been a long week for you, for us?
I'm not sure I'm actually allowed to talk about it, Paul.
No, it's under NDA, but I think we can say we've been playing with metahumans this week, and we've also tried out multi-user editing in Unreal, which was great because we could do like live, all be in the same project. So we could move cameras and lights around and we could actually see the avatar of the other person in there.
You guys doing the same paid gig then?
Yeah, I ended up jumping in on some of the collaborative stuff and then towards the end, just giving a hand with the editing and a few lights. But Fred did the bulk of it going in.
For context, we're all on a boot camp course to become 3D artists or to get into the 3D art, film, games industry in some sort of way. I had a really nice meeting with Freya on Sunday. That's a week ago Sunday. We talked for hours and hours and hours about biophilic design, capitalism, just literally everything. We had a really good time and I'm really happy she's on board with the project.
Yeah, me too.
They need to love each other.
Naturally, there's a question that comes up when somebody joins a team like Freya, who's got these amazing ideas and she sees the world in a different way and sees the future in a different way. She's presented and entered lots of ideas now into this. Do you want to talk a little bit about those, Loretta, just to sort of summarize those? And
okay, so as a head of story, I had some concerns about where the story was going because we were going to build the story of the main film, which I thought was already fairly formed, the story about the robot, who is a housekeeping robot, who's lonely, and he meets a family. It's a short film. It's supposed to be heartwarming. And I think my main concern about that is that heartwarming stories have to be relatable, and the architecture has to be relatable. It has to look like a house that you would live in. It has to look homely and warm. And some of Freya's biophilic designs are based on shells, which it's a process, you know. It's not the end point. We just want to keep that sense of hominess. And so I raised this with Paul and we talked about it. I love the work that she's doing. It just is about whether we're going to stay the course or change it or how that's going to be managed. And the answer is Paul is going to manage it because he's the manager.
It raises a good question with what Freya's put forward is it, just to explain it for people listening, is like you said, the biophilic design goes much further and the way that would have to come about in the story effectively changes. So we'd lose that sort of red house that we've been in love with. We'd lose some stuff and we'd trade it up for houses that look more grown, made out of natural materials like shell-like materials and other. And it opens up this whole really fascinating idea, the biophilic thing, which I'm starting to understand. I want to build those ideas into it, but I don't want to lose what's there. So I think one way that we discussed moving forward with it would be we build in Freya's view into the story. Maybe it doesn't happen on this planet. Maybe it's something that happens like in the next planet that's kind of transformed.
Totally. I don't see it as like Freya's thing and the existing thing as being two separate things. We need to choose one or the other. I kind of see it as being like, what if the ultimate goal, because remember, this is set in the future, but the future is also going to have a future of its own, and perhaps Freya's goal is the ultimate goal, and the robots have to sort of get to that point, you know, and perhaps we're not even aware that they're going to get to that point. So I think it's just about trying to and also the house that we kind of spent months sort of working on, you know, the red one, that could be something that's kind of like a, you know, those things that at building sites, those portable buildings, offices, they just sort of drop in with a crane and pick up. That could essentially be the thing that you dump on the planet. And the biophilic design is what the robots are building. So there's a way to accommodate lots of different things in there. It's just about being respectful of what's already developed and just...
Exactly. Loretta, you add something.
On a more practical level, labor is expensive. Ideas are cheap. She's really great artist. I love her work. It's beautiful. She has a really sense, like a really good eye for stuff.
She's in as far as I think.
Exactly.
I said how to accommodate those ideas.
Exactly. I think I'm really still very excited about the idea of having a fossil record of robots. I still want to work that into the webcomic when I get around to it. Yeah, so that was my week.
Nice. I actually had a chat with Mario 2 days ago. And he's
conceptized.
Yes, he's very excited about jumping back in. He's at that point now where he's just like, yeah, he's got a lot of momentum. I think he's just sick and tired of being static and he just wants to get busy and get his hands dirty. And you know, I told him that, you know, a big thing right now is that, you know, a lot of people are talking to us about how we're using AI art. And I think a good niche for him would be to try and figure out a nice workflow for him using AI art. And I think that the comic might be a good starting point to experiment with that with him, and we can support him through that.
I agree. That and storyboards for the show would be...
Yeah, exactly. It's just, you know, whatchamacallit, because of this week that we've had, this coming week is the last kind of week I have to finish up the procedural robots with Murphy.
Because he's away for a month in like half a week or a week.
But let's just say, like, starting 1st of October, we'll do like 60% of my time will be split on the project, the film, and we'll do 30% time tucked away for the comic and just see if we can get that rolling. But like, you know, just getting these tasks done in the way that we're doing it is that, you know, what we're doing with Murphy can feed straight into the webcomic. You know, once we've got a few of these iterative, you know, procedural robots, we can take those renders, stick them in Midjourney, exactly, to our thing. So it's, you know, it's all a web.
Exactly. And we've looked at a couple of comic, I was looking at a few comic platforms and they look like really nice ways to bring in images, you know, the text, to do some interesting layouts with boards. It looks like it would give us a lot of freedom and they're very cheap. They are used by professionals and they do look good. We're always looking for ways, given the size of the team, we're always looking for ways to cut things down. And I think it's worth making a point about Murphy in that regard, because he is what would be known in VFX, at least, as a TD. A technical director is a dev on a technical artist on a team that builds tools for other people, or just to do something to a rig, or to automate something like pushing something into the pipeline or pulling it out of the pipeline. And for us, we talked about one of the main things we were doing last week was messing around with these lights. And actually, we came up with the idea for a little tool that somebody like Murphy, I would love for him to build us something so that we can do more of that work in future faster, whereby one or two or three clicks be able to set up some interesting
lights. I've been having some very, very good ideas in the last 24 hours on
great
features for that and how we can rig some certain things up and some defaults we can have.
Yeah, I think that's good, because we're moving into a place... That other project has pushed us into a place where we're now being more collaborative, like literally more collaborative on a project live. And we're trying to explore that a bit more. And Loretta, you brought in Notion into our lives and pushed for having more of a, not necessarily a schedule, but it's currently very hand to mouth. And we do need to get better at that.
We've been working on this project since June, on and off, as team members have come in and gone out. We need some kind of operational organizational tool, because a team like this needs to know where we're at any given time. Paul suggested we try Notion. I quite like it. I quite like that you can label everything and then search by task or search by bigger task. I quite like that, the nested quality. So I hope we use that nested quality to organize our work. Yeah. And it also means that people coming in, like Freya, have one place to look at what people have been doing.
Yeah.
I think that she was sort of feeling like she didn't know where to fit in. And I think if we have an operational organization tool like Notion, our team could just be like, you know, look at this, spend 5 minutes looking at this, see where you can fit in. And it'll help us create that art Bible you were talking about.
There's an art director who'd be willing to talk to me and just give me a bit of feedback and help. And he actually did a really nice video presentation at a conference that I've been watching. And that's helped me to understand what I'm missing on this project that exactly as you're saying, that Freya should have had when she joined and everybody else should have, which is the art Bible. And I'm starting to understand better how that fits together, what that's supposed to, how that really needs to be there to communicate to everybody. This is what it is, but also importantly, it seems integral to an art Bible to say this is what this isn't.
So the agreed.
Project is this, but not that. It's, you know, it's in the future, but it's not dystopian. It's this, but it's not that. It's this. I didn't quite fully appreciate that the not is as important as the is. And this is something we all need to input into for sure. But I'm going to try and start next week pulling together an art Bible, putting it on Notion, so we've got a guideline to the whole thing. A Bible.
In game design, you have the game design documents, the level design documents, and then the environment design documents within that. And it's kind of, there's kind of like a hierarchy of how things are laid out. So we just need to get all the facets. And you're right, like we're not moving in a straight line. It's like we're ice skating. We have to go left, then go right, then go left, go right. So it's trying to find that balance between where we want to sit ourselves between opposites, I guess.
Exactly. So the other thing we did this week was talk to Martin Bell. And he's a previz artist, and he's just made a 10-minute, during COVID, he made a 10-minute short film based on the true story of a chap in the First World War. His work immediately hits you as being it's a really, really impressive 10-minute film. In a second, we'll jump over to the interview that Fred and I did this week with Martin, and it was a fascinating discussion.
It was all about how to get it done, really. I mean, he's a lovely chap, and it was really good, but obviously there was like a struggle of being able to get it done, and the compromises and the choices that he made. But at the same time, it was like every decision he made was just about getting it done, and it was great. He did it really, really well, and it looks like he put a lot more effort in than maybe he did in areas. Like maybe it just comes naturally to him, but it was very, very impressive.
Yeah, it's very cinematic. There's a definite choice with the art style there that's made me think a lot deeper about the art style we originally talked about in terms of realism. Martin's is a perfect example of storytelling first, and then the use of Unreal second. Like he used Unreal to tell a story.
I think that short stories are very appropriate for science fiction because a lot of science fiction is about concepts and ideas rather than about plot. Yeah. So I know that they're not as popular as novels, but they can be really good to illustrate concepts.
Let's play the interview. Let me introduce you, Martin. You became an animator over 15 years ago. Now you're in film visualization, previz, and postviz. You've helped create huge action sequences for blockbuster franchises such as Jurassic World, a couple of Marvel movies, Fast and Furious, James Bond, the film that I wasn't prepared for when I watched it, and Aquaman. Also in there is The Little Mermaid. The trailer for that's just dropped, and I think everybody's really pleased with what they're seeing. Aladdin, 1917, amazing film, and Wheel of Time. You've been writing screenplays for years. 2021, your true crime drama Dead Man's Hill earned a reader recommended accolade on the blacklist, and you've recently completed production of your fifth and most ambitious solo CGI animated film, Prazinburk Ridge, which is an absolutely fantastic and very engaging 10-minute film created in Unreal Engine using cutting-edge virtual production techniques. It is completely engaging, and I'll tell you, I think it came across my LinkedIn, and I thought, oh, okay, I've got 10 minutes. And the bit that pulled me into it was the match cut from the rugby ball being kicked to the bomb exploding in the air. So I was thinking, okay, this is interesting. Where's this going? Sound was good. Music's there. And then as soon as that match cut happened, I thought, I'm in good hands. And I just relaxed and watched and thoroughly enjoyed the whole thing. So I think it's a good place to start. Before we talk about the film, can you describe what previz is and what the general process is of that?
Yeah, so previz is is basically the process of animating a live action feature film or part of it before a frame is shot, because shooting a frame costs a lot of money, and having half a dozen people kind of animate it in advance to check what works and what doesn't work is much cheaper. So I started on Jurassic World Fallen Kingdom as an artist, really, but I didn't know if I was going to be any good at it. I come from an animation background, but obviously when you're an animator, you do learn about shot composition and editing and things like that, only in passing, because an animator needs to know kind of a good overview of the entire process, even acting. So
you mentioned that you did this in the pandemic, and looking through your films, there's, you know, you've got a script on the blacklist. There was that the Noseratu inspired the one on the boat, which was a really nice sequence, and that and I think I picked up on the fact that there's obviously a couple of projects you're floating that you could have picked. Tell me what led up to you choosing to do this story. Why did you do it? Why pick this over the other? Why put this ahead of the other stories?
Well, I knew that if I was going to make something in Unreal, I want to be able to leverage the marketplace, because I'm not an asset person. I had no intention of building anything original. I just wanted to take assets that I could find online commercially. You know, everything was bought, but I didn't want to be having to make anything. So anything that would have to be custom made or designed, that I didn't want to have to do. So there's an element of design to Prazinburk Ridge, but it's like a collage almost. There are things I've downloaded and bought off and applied things to and changed things. I wrote a short years and years ago, which was intended to be kind of like a sideways look at the Dracula story, where the guy who's coming to visit, he needs to be served, you know, and in the Nosferatu serves him this beautiful platter, and I was like, well, where's he got that from? Who's made that? Like, he must have made it. He's the only one in the castle, so he must have gone shopping. And I had this idea, like a funny sequence already, like Nosferatu has to go shopping to the market and buy all this stuff and learn how to cook for a human and things like that. And that's something that like could be done in this format, but yeah, in my mind, it was kind of like production designed a little bit. And I didn't really think I had the opportunity to do that, and there's almost certainly going to be custom things needed to be done. Now, that said, I very quickly thought that I'd be able to rope some friends in to help.
Yeah.
But the idea was effectively just pick something that I can get plenty of assets for without going the route of sci-fi. I mean, I like sci-fi as much as the next person, but I'm not someone who probably fully understands the genre. And I think I'd be almost doing it just for the sake of it. And I didn't want to be doing something just for the sake of it. Although I was fully aware that that is exactly what I was doing. I was doing something just for the sake of it.
But you needed to connect to it.
Yeah, exactly.
But the connection is through your brother. So yes. Your brother writes this book called
The Man of All Talents.
Called The Man of All Talents. Can you just tell us what is the premise of Dougie's story? And how is your brother, who worked, I think, if I looked up the right person, works National Grid, but he's also a sports writer.
Yeah.
Can you, like, it's the most grounded thing ever. It's just not, the whole thing is so unpretentious and it's so grounded. And I think maybe that there's something about a northern element to me.
I think there is. I think that's me and my brother to a T, really. So he had written, he always wanted to be a writer, and as we both did, although we didn't really know at the time. And I was writing my first screenplay, not the fan script that I had written first, it was just a practice. And this is after I'd started on Jurassic World Fallen Kingdom. This was in 2017. He was writing a book about a Brazilian football team called Chapecoense, who died in a plane crash. And he managed to pitch it to a publisher called Pitch. So he was writing that and I was writing my script. And at some point we were talking, because we talk every day, and now we talk most days, we talk about writing, but back then we were just talking every day just because we do. And it came up that we were both doing some writing, and we said, oh, well, let's swap and we'll read each other's work. And so we did, and we just carried on that. I mean, nowadays, even if he writes an email, he asks me to proofread it, and I'll do the same with him as well, like if it's a professional thing, or articles that he writes, things like that, I'll always get first look at them. Same thing with me, I've just written an article and I'd send it to him first. And so he wrote the book and it did quite well. And he was looking for a second subject and something a bit closer to home. And he was looking at, there's a wrestler, a professional wrestler from our village called Mal Kirk. And he was looking at doing Mal's story, and he didn't quite see the book in it. It was an interesting story, but it wasn't maybe like, I think from what he could find, full book. But while he was doing this research, Malkirk was known as Mucky Malkirk. He was a pit man. While he was doing this research, he found about this man, Douglas Clark, who lived in Huddersfield, which is where my brother lives. He was also a coal man. He was called, he didn't work down the pits. He was a coal delivery man. My brother was trying to find information about him, and he seemed to find this information about a man who was a coal delivery man. He was a rugby player. He was a war hero. And he was a professional wrestler. And my brother was like an amateur wrestler as well.
Right.
Where I was like, this can't be all the same person. And the more he found out, the more he realized it was all the same remarkable person who lived a humble life in Huddersfield, delivering coal, even in the Second World War, delivering coal. And so he started writing, you know, started doing his research and writing the book. And he managed to get in touch with Douglas's last surviving family member. And she had a treasure trove of Douglas's things that he got to look at. He drove up to her house and she gave him sandwiches and tea, and he wrote the book, and she's delighted with the book and the film now. And yeah, so it started there. And then when I was trying to think of a subject, and I thought like things that are often in games, because that's where best assets are going to be on the marketplace. Yeah. And after sci-fi and fantasy, I thought war. And I was thinking about like, well, what, because war's good. It's just an action sequence. I can make an action sequence. That's what I do for a living, is make action sequences. But then I remembered about this particular exciting sequence in my brother's book. So I dug out my idea A4 that I proofread for him and scrawled in, you know, bits of red and here and there where I've notes for him. And I flicked to the page trying to find it and reread it. And I remembered being able to see the action as I read it. So much of Prazinburk Ridge is the action that I saw reading my brother's words the first time I read it. And so I just sent him a message saying, yeah, can I do this? And of course he went, yeah, of course you can. I don't think he expected it to go this far, but he said, yeah, sure. And then that was that.
What was your brother's reaction when he watched it? And did he sort of proofread, you know, was he...
He read the script. He'd read the script. And I wasn't there. So I screened my first previz cut in July 2020 to my parents. Right. It was just when lockdown ended, my parents came to visit. So I screened it to my parents and my wife, who's then my fiance. And my dad started crying, but he cries all the time, so we don't really have to worry about that. but I couldn't be there when my brother watched the previz cut.
Right.
The thing about the previz cut, though, is it's previz, and they don't really see previz very much, don't really know what it is.
No.
And there is an element of, in previz, there's an element of being able to use your imagination, especially when you've got dialogue scenes where the characters aren't talking, they're not necessarily even looking in the right direction because they haven't got control of their eyes yet or anything.
Yeah.
You know, so there's an element of that. It's still not that impressive, but I remember I sent him a clip of, well, actually the poster image that I'm using of Douglas Clark leaping for the ball. Mm-hmm. I that was the first time he saw the new look. I remember he said, wow, on the message. And then I sent him a whole clip of it, like the first minute or so after I had that done. His reaction was positive, but I wasn't there in person to get the full effect.
He is coming
to the screening on next Saturday, though.
I was going to say, it would be nice to watch that together, to kind of share that moment together.
Yeah, so
I must say, I'm envious of the relationship you have with your brother. It sounds like a very supportive thing you've got going there.
No, it is, yeah, it is.
Yeah, that's wonderful.
Well, I mean, we've got that going a little bit, Fred, have we not? Are we...
Yeah, bro.
I mean, we're not brothers, but we're supportive. I mean, yeah, I think this is, it's nice finding people that you can work with, and you'll have that shorthand with your brother. So it's clear that there was a story there. Like I said, the thing that really pulled me in immediately, which just made me settle in and watch the whole thing, was that match cut. Because I that was just fantastic.
Thanks.
Just that choice. And it immediately allowed me to kind of suspend disbelief, and you've got throughout the film, you've got these kind of J and L cuts going on where we're pulled in and out of what is kind of him now on the rugby pitch, like he previously thinking about something, and somehow, and I said this to you when I messaged you, there's somehow you're just gently pulled into the situation that's increasingly dangerous.
That's it, isn't it? It's, you kind of felt like you were there rather than you were being shown something. And
Yeah, so it's a little bit by design because this is their job day to day. So to start with, it's nothing particularly extraordinary. The only difference on this day is that the shelling is particularly heavy. So I didn't want it to be, although actually I've hit the nose on the head harder than I intended. I had someone watch it a couple of weeks before I released it, and said they didn't understand what was going on. So I added, I changed the line when the truck goes down the thing and the Williams, a Scottish, says, "You don't want to be near that truck if you shell it." That wasn't the line. I had to add that just to make things absolutely clear, but try not to hit the nail on the head completely.
I think that works. It works really well. Because
it was the right choice. Yeah, you're right. I was being too kind of vague before, and I was,
there is a balance, isn't there?
Yeah. And I was trying my hardest to not. And the other thing, the first version of that opening scene had dialogue. It had an extra character. It had his wife in it, and there was a lot of exposition about he's going off to war. This will all still be here when you come back. And I was like, I don't think I need any of this dialogue. Like it can be told. The poster tells most of the story, and that's a real poster too. I changed the images and recreated it, but it's based on a real poster.
Right.
And that tells the whole story. It says like the quote is, "This is not the time to play games." On the poster, like, look, you've got to go. Like, it's as simple as that. So I didn't think we needed this long scene of dialogue with him and his wife.
Well, no, because when you're in a situation, you never get the full picture anyway. Yeah. It's always just whatever you get at the time. So that's kind of added to the realism. Yeah, definitely.
There's something in it. It does feel right from the off. You're in for a sort of, you know, someone walking onto an empty pitch. It's a great way to set the scene, but it also sets up the sense of isolation for him. There's a longing for something, and you're not sure, is he remembering that he was a rugby player, or is, you know, he used to play and he can't play anymore. It has a very specific art direction to it. It has a specific look. It's not previz, but there is an element where I think with all animations, particularly for some adults, people stand off from it. And that's what I think, one reason I think people have tried to pursue hyperrealism or naturalism so well. Why didn't you go down that route? What made you choose this art style instead of saying, I am metahumans, everything else, I'm going to go for hyperrealism?
Because you ever hear Kevin Smith talk about why he made Clerks in black and white?
No.
He couldn't afford color film. And I couldn't make it photoreal. Like, I would need a team, but I could do this. So it was born out of necessity, really. I didn't think I would like the look of it. I thought it was just something I would have to live with, but actually, it drove it to a place where it's actually quite unique looking, entirely by accident, really. But, and through experimentation, I spent a couple of weeks in April this year when I picked the film back up. It was that kind of in a, stasis, really, from the end of 2020. I didn't really know what to do with it. I couldn't finish it on my own. And so when I picked it back up in April, I spent a week or two experimenting with looks that I thought would. So effectively, if you think like that truck cost $2 from a website. It was not, it was never going to be able to go in a photoreal film. And so it would need me to hire, and I can't model it and use and make PBR materials for it. So I'd need to hire someone at the very least to make that truck. And then if that truck looks photoreal, then actually that sort of painterly sky that I was using probably wants to be redone.
Yeah.
A lot of the other stuff needs to be redone. It would have just caused a ripple effect that would have just made the film never got finished.
So was that what you just mentioned, that you kind of got stuck? What was the thing that stuck you? Was it that you said you didn't know how to finish it, but was it the art direction essentially that...
It was the fact that I didn't like the characters. They didn't sit. They've not got proper PBR materials, and so they didn't sit nicely. I wanted to go metahumans. If I did that, then I would have to replace every animation with a metahuman. Rather than just replacing in the pipeline that I've got, I can push Dougie's facial features around in Mudbox and update the asset that way, and that's fine. But in order to use metahumans or any other character for that matter, I would need to redo the whole film.
And
it just wasn't an option. It's like, if the goal is to finish it, which that was the goal, there's no money, there's no help, nothing's coming. I just need to, I've done a lot of work and I need to make it presentable enough that I can show people. If that's the goal, then replacing all the animation and all the characters wasn't an option. So I had to go with what I had already. I tried replacing the characters' heads with metahuman heads, which I'd done on a previous film, which worked okay. But on this film, because the characters had, particularly Dougie, has quite, he's big, like his big hands, he's really out, he's not got realistic human proportions. The metahuman head just didn't sit on him, like didn't look right. So it's a case of working with what I had, really. And I didn't like applying the cell shading to everything because I thought that some things were working quite nicely and that was already slightly stylized. It's particularly the sky and the level itself. And then when I found it's called the Kuahara filter, the kind of the thing that gives it the sort of painterly effect. And I liked that fine, but I didn't like it on its own. But I just found that when I use a combination of cell shading certain objects in the scene and having the painterly effect on everything. Yeah. In an ideal world, I think I might not have used the painterly effect on the characters. But that would have added in my experimentation. I found that in order to do that, I would have had to render every shot at least twice.
Right.
In order to get a clean character on a mat that can then be applied to the, and I was like, that's going to take too long. So again, it was one of those.
Are you familiar with The War of Art by Stephen Pressfield?
Yes, I am. Yeah.
Right. I recommend that book to anybody that's any kind of creative or artist. You don't have to be a writer to read that book. Was there elements of resistance to it that you, not that we find excuses, but you know, sometimes you look at something, you say, well, it's not quite good enough and I need to, so yeah, I'll finish it later. And you find these reasons to start putting it off and not finish it.
That was exactly it.
Where does it come? Can you talk about that a little bit? Because it's something that, you know, someone who's associated with the team has been struggling with that. He's gone through that. I've definitely gone through that. And I think it's an important thing to discuss. And
no, I absolutely agree. I thought it was worth pursuing. And to be honest, like I was hoping I'd be able to get some funding and might offset some of my losses in the pandemic and things like that. And then those things just didn't materialize. And it was, and I showed it to one of my VFX supervisor friends and he said the same thing. He said, just get it voiceovered and put it out. So then it's worth something. It's an achievement then sitting on the computer. It's not anything.
No.
But I wanted it to look a certain way. I wanted it to look like a video game cinematic, really.
Yeah.
And ideally, really, I wanted it to be live action. Like, you know, I'm a live action previz supervisor, formerly an animator. I've animated it because that's what I know how to do. And I can do that on my own. But it still wasn't, it was sat there and when I made the trailer, in order to put the trailer together, I kind of like hacked into the edit and stuff and picked out a few shots and things like that. And when I watched it back, I was like, I think I've over-noodled this now. It's not anything and I can't show it to anyone and it's just not good enough. And I said at the time, and I've always said, there's a good film in there, but I need help to get it out, to get the good film out. But this was before I had the idea of adding the speech that kind of forms the backbone of the second half. The speech is real. The speech is in my brother's book, but it's from a separate part of his life. It's actually called the Rorke's Drift Test Match in Australia. It was Great Britain versus Australia. And when he talks about right versus wrong and things like that, this team were badly treated as they went to Australia and they were very much underdogs, but they battled through and overcome. And that was the speech that the coach gave to them before they went out to play the match. And I'd remembered this speech and I looked it back up in his book and there was even mentioned it on a centenary past, I think in 2014, and there was an article about the match. And I just thought, that's so, so good. And I think even the article said, like, it's like something from a Hollywood blockbuster. And I just thought, I should use that, really. Yeah. And then I had the idea that I could get a scene in at the start. I didn't want to do too much jumping around, but it just seemed to fit in the start. I could just have him flashback as he's remembering it. And then it meant that he could recall it later. And when I added that to the script, suddenly I was sat looking and going, this needs to be made now. Like, it's something that should have been made before, but now I'm like, I need to make this. And I felt an overwhelming urge that I need to find a way to do it, but I still didn't know how. Yeah. And then I saw the trailer for Richard Linklater's new film, Apollo 10 and a Half, which is rotoscoped. And so it looks cel-shaded. And I just thought, oh, Unreal can do that. And then very quickly that thought went, well, if Unreal does that, then I could do it on two. So it's an animation term for 12 frames a second.
Yeah.
Which gives it even more of an animation-y feel. It also
The whole thing on twos?
The whole thing's on twos. And it also means it halves the amount of animation I've got to do. And I like the look of things on twos. Like I've always been a big fan of that. And it really does help animation-wise. Like it's less than half the work for me, I think. When I was learning to animate, I used to animate on twos and then I would just turn the splines on to fill in the frames in between and then just quickly edit those because I got better at it, but at the time it was the easiest way I could think of doing to think of it as 12 separate drawings instead of like a 24 frame animation. And then it all just sort of fit. And then I thought, well, that truck that would otherwise need building, it's got a cell shader on it. So who cares? Like, it doesn't matter that it's not photoreal. And it's the same thing goes with all the other assets that maybe weren't quite up to scratch, including the characters.
The look of it is completely unified. So it's interesting because to talk about the resistance thing, I can hear where you came over that resistance, but it's hard sometimes to know when is it resistance? When am I hurting the project, or when am I stopping myself releasing something good, versus you also mentioned that moment of intuition that kind of crept in where you're like, something's not right, you know? And if you pushed too hard and released it, you wouldn't have been happy with it, versus when you unlock it, suddenly that rush of sort of energy comes in and you're like, right, I'm doing it. This is actually quite good. It's enough for me to release it.
That's exactly it. There's two alternate endings that I tried as well.
But oh, really?
The only reason I didn't do them was because this is the ending that it always had, with the photographs at the end.
Yeah.
That was always the original ending. So it's just a shot of him in the water. The slug scientist, he survived. And then there's the photographs.
Yeah.
Those were all based on real photographs that we had, but I wasn't sure I could get them. We wouldn't even know where the rights exist for them. So I just thought, given this film, I'll just recreate them and it's fine. Yeah. But there was two other endings and I wanted to try them both, but it would have meant not releasing the film for how long, I don't know. And it's hard enough trying to do this in your spare time when you've a full-time job. And the amount of extra work that would have been involved. I mean, one of them had a whole new environment, which would have brought my environment count to 4 and a whole another character as well. And I was like, I can't do it. It's like, it's good enough. Like it gets to the point. I don't need to belabor that. There's a chance that I use both endings. Actually, you could use one or the other, or use both. The one of them involved another going back to the rugby ground again. And I had a beautiful match cut that again worked, but I just thought, like, I've got the point home, and everyone talks about the transitions. And I think that's why I was really keen to do it. It's because everyone's talking about everyone that watched it said, oh, the transitions are great. So yeah. I'll do more of them. And at a certain point, it's like, well, it's going to push it past 10 minutes, which is, there's no point pushing it past 10 minutes. It's not going to sustain that. And so those are the ones that got jettisoned, and it's actually in the script. But I just thought I just stuck with my original ending, and just so that it could be finished, you know?
Yeah. But I mean, 10 minutes is impressive. I mean, that's a huge amount of work when you think about it.
Yeah.
For one person.
Yeah.
I mean, that's
like you're having to produce it yourself right here, like everything, yeah, you know, be your own boss. Yeah. It's a lot of work.
Yeah. And I didn't want to have to add to that. And also like I can't tell you the burden is it became a couple of times, like in 2020, I was obsessed, but I had to be obsessed because we were in the middle of like a pandemic and we had to have something to focus on.
Yeah.
But then earlier this year, as I was doing the drive to just like, get it done, and I had a spreadsheet with like tasks that I was like, I'm just gonna robot through all of them, like take that off, tick that off, tick that off, tick that off. And the burden, the weight of it. I remember one weekend I spent all weekend doing, I think it was facial animation, a shot after shot after shot after shot, and I'm spending maybe an hour and a half on each one, which is not really long enough. And I think it shows, I think some of the animation, some of the lip sync doesn't land, but there was that much of it to do, and there's not a wasted line in there. There's not a character speaking a line that doesn't need to be spoken, and the weight of it, the burden. Oh, I was saying burden, not if burden's the right word, but there's a feel of like, I need this to be over. I guess it's the end of a really, just a real long process, and I need to be done with this now. It needs to stop. And if I allow myself, if I allow myself the indulgence of like trying out new endings and pushing back a release date and missing festival submission dates and things like that, I'm like,
yeah, it's just, this is resistance creeping in, right? This is the excuse to stop, the excuse. And it's what Pressfield says in that book, which is do the work, sit down and do the work, even when you don't want to, even when you can't, when you're sick of it, you just have to sit down and do the work. And I mean, it's a testament to what you've done, in that you kept the story, to be able to protect the story from yourself is much harder, I think, than protecting it from someone else, because the need that other person who's going to come in, like, no, fiddle with it, have a, like you said, you know, put another transition in. People love transitions. This sort of the Hollywood producer kind of, you know, let's put another money shot it, you know, just like, well, wait, hang on, let's,
I think, just... this is something that every artist struggles with, is that you, when you're working, you slip into experimentation when you should just be working. There's a time for everything, but then when you need to get something done, you can get lost in infinite possibilities.
And I did, like, a week or two before I wanted to release it, I spent a day and a half like trying out these new endings, like doing previews for the new endings, and then when they were sort of starting to work immediately, because that first sequence wasn't like that, and that came together very quickly in April, because the previous version had been the one where his wife was in it and they were speaking So I just thought, like, oh, well, that's how fast I can knock a minute long sequence out, like, in a matter of days. So that's fine. I'll just do it again. And then when it didn't all just fall into place immediately, it's like, ah, right, if I carry on down
you
here.
You get that confidence boost. And then bite off more than you can
chew. Exactly. This is not working as well as I wanted it to. I think maybe I just need to abort this avenue and get back to doing the work, like you said.
Do you feel like that on a shot level, on a sequence level, or on a short film level? Or all of those things? Is there a bar you're setting? It sounded like that was happening a bit at the shot level. So yeah, talk to me about that.
So it depends how you qualify a film as to how many I've done. For me, this is the first proper standalone film.
Right.
The other four are all have qualifiers to them. This is the first film that could get into a festival. For one, my first film was I've already mentioned Kevin Smith, but my first film was a Kevin Smith kind of fan film that he's seen and liked. My second one was a little more than an animated ident for my own company.
Right.
The third one was a Litia, which you've seen, then sort of Noseratu on a boat type thing. And the fourth one was Black Seam, which is a script that I've written, a 60-page script for three part series. And the teaser is just, it's a teaser for something else. It's not a film in its own right. So,
I see. Because it's a great, that's another story that pulls you in, of just the guy in the bar, very northern, you know, storytelling. But again, that you can tell your action background in the sequence as it plays through is fantastic underneath. The belly of the beast. And the thing is, like, it's really good. Again,
I'm super proud of it. It has issues. Like, I don't like the lip sync. Again, the lip sync is a real problem. But I am super proud of it. But it's not a piece in itself. Intended to be something. It's meant to be a period live action drama. So it's got that qualifier to it, which Prazinburk Ridge doesn't have. And so the next thing, I don't know. I'm entertaining ideas of doing a live action feature. I'm trying to, I've got an idea of how to contain one so that I can actually get it made, in the same way that I had to contain Prazinburk Ridge in order to get it made. So I'm thinking now about writing pieces rather than me having to contain Prazinburk Ridge after the fact and pull it back into something manageable, actually creating something manageable in the first place that can be made. The thing that was on a blacklist, for example, is an 8-part 1960s set true crime drama. I mean, I can make that. There's no version of that I can make on my own.
No.
I'm trying to make sure that the next thing that I put my attention to is something that can be made and is designed to be made, you know.
Do you think you might change your opinion of that, like in the future? Do you think it might be something that you actually realize, actually, unless it's something I don't think I can make, it's not worth making?
Maybe. I don't know. I know that, like, that's true crime drama is the other thing that I was obsessed with in the lockdown period, and I started writing that then as well, and it does mean a lot to me. I want it to be done. If it's going to get done, I want it to be done kind of right. Every time I come to, I've got like an unreal scene for it that I keep sort of teasing myself that I might make something. And so far, it's been a poster, and that's it. And I don't know that I'm going to go further.
Someone holding a gun as a car going off through like a cornfield, and
I
mean, that was good. It sets it up really nicely.
Yeah.
Let me ask. What I want to do is spin this around. So one of the reasons for getting people on to the podcast was to understand, you know, how you work your workflow, and then kind of turn it around and get all the insights we can and all the advice. Maybe your advice is don't do it. Are you mad? I'm more interested in kind of cinematography, camera, that side of storytelling. And I thought, well, I can't do a thing till I've done a thing, so I should get something going. So talking to Fred and a few people on the course, like, who wants to do something? A few of us came together and said, look, we're all into sci-fi. We did the same thing you did and said, we're all into sci-fi. Should we go there? Because we had a mix of a few different skill sets on the team. And then the funny thing that happened was Fred in particular, started playing with Midjourney, the AI image generation thing. And we were working with a traditional concept artist, and he's still with us on the team. And Fred started getting more and more out of this. You know, we're having a session with a concept artist where we look at a few sketches, and then Fred would kind of go, oh, I've got these 60 images I did in about 2 hours. And we just look at all these wildly different robots and things. And suddenly we saw one that made everyone say, oh my God, that's it. That's the right. And because the AI isn't a concept artist, you have to fill in the gaps. Mm. You're like, well, what is that? What is that glass thing there? What would... And that started this very natural conversation about, oh, how would that work? And okay, that would need to be a plant system. And Fred produced an image of a house.
I didn't see it, but I've watched the trailer.
Oh, did you watch the trailer? Yeah. What did you think of the trailer?
I mean, the trailer, that's
what did you think of the trailer?
I liked it. It's a good idea. Like I said, and there's a joke in it that made me laugh as well. What was the joke? I can't remember.
NFTs
and metaverse, yeah, which is, yeah, I think that's very, very cutting.
Yeah,
just sneak that one in there. Yeah.
It's not everyone noticed it, but I did a little loading screen when it talks about Unreal. It freezes and it's waiting to load, and that was a little dig at shaders.
Yeah, actually, I think everybody that was watching that thought there was something wrong with the video at that.
Yeah, but you can see then what we're kind of trying to do. What I'm already learned from what you've said is, we need to be careful of kind of scope creep and kind of where it's going.
Scope creep is exactly the word I was about to use, yeah. Right. I scope creeped myself on this.
What would your advice be for like a general workflow? How soon would you lock the story down? And being a previz guy, is storyboarding essential? Do we make this film twice? Do we make it once in the animatic, in the storyboard, and then we, you know, we bring it to life?
I don't know if... what I was cautious of is a similar thing. As I said, I didn't want to make the film twice. I'd already made it once. And if I was to use new characters, I'd be making it again. I don't know if storyboarding counts as making it twice. If you're using the right people, you don't necessarily need to have the world's greatest storyboard artist to just be able to effectively do a graphical shot list.
Yeah.
So, yeah, you know, I want this shot, and I want this shot, and I want this shot, and just a little thumbnail just to make sure you've kind of got what it is that you want to do. I didn't really do that. I did on my first print for the script. I went through and I thumbnailed all of my little ideas for each shot just as they came up in the script. And some of them are exactly as they are now, and some of them just wildly changed as I experimented with things. So I don't think you need to make it twice. I think storyboarding is not a bad idea when you're a team, because everyone wants to be on the same page. But you can do an element of storyboarding in Unreal, and there are tools you can get to do that as well.
EPOS, I think it's called, isn't it?
I don't, because I'm working on my own, I didn't bother storyboarding except for a few thumbnails, and I would go in and I'd just get the previz working. But
I'm surprised, because it really does look like you storyboarded
but it's
very polished, like very deliberate.
It's my job though. I mean, creating shots all day, every day.
You see in your mind, you know what you're going to get when you see it.
It's like a good
photographer. They know... the picture's going to look like.
Sometimes it doesn't work when you see it in motion, though. And the same will always go with storyboards. Sometimes I'll get storyboards that have been signed off, and I'll see them, and I'm like, actually, that's not... I can see already, because I see things in motion, because it's my job, that one's not going to work, and I'll need a solution for that. Yeah. But I still have to kind of make it and show it to the client. It's like, look, this is what it was, but this is not going to work for these reasons, and that's perfectly understandable. Sometimes it's just the set, like the storyboard artist hasn't got the physical set.
Yeah.
To work with, and so she's like, look, you can't get that shot in this set, so we have to do something else. So I think if you're working in a team, it's probably worth doing at least a thumbnail pass and but probably no more than that.
I enjoy that anyway.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, I think
process. It's, I think when you're working in a team, you need to communicate, but you didn't obviously need to show anyone, you just needed to just get cracking.
Exactly.
Right?
Yeah, that's exactly it. Yeah. But I think the main thing is, for me, I would don't be tempted to use Unreal as a renderer. I can't say this to enough people. It's easier to do your layout in Unreal than it is in anything else. Like, it's much, much faster. Make use of mocap, get the mocap into Unreal, start laying out shots. When you've got your shot list, start laying out the shots. You can even do edits, really easy to do edits in Unreal as a master sequence. And you can really start to, I've had it worse, because the fun bit for me is when you start to put those things together, go, oh, I need a shot, I need an over,
over
his shoulder. I'll just go make one and I stick it in the edit, and I've not left Unreal yet. And I can sort of see it starting to work. There's some imagination involved, because you're not going to get it exactly right without having some animation and things like that. And you know, it's kind of a sketch at the minute. But to get that, so that's sort of phase one, and it, you know, that's the loosest bit. Don't do any animation in Maya, not touch Maya yet. Just get it all into Unreal, get it all work, so the sequence works, show it to a few people, make sure everyone understands the logic, the story, the geography, and then you can start rendering them shots out and get them into your whatever your conventional editing package is. You are going to want to do that, because the effects in Unreal are of a generation, a spawn point. And if your spawn point is outside of your edit point, so let's say there's an explosion in Prazinburk Ridge and I don't want to see the actual explosion, I'll come into it a few frames later. Because it comes into a few frames later, it hasn't triggered the explosion. So that shot doesn't have the explosion. You are going to want to render this full shot and get all that stuff in and then put it back together. But you can export the EDL or whatnot from Unreal and get it, rebuild it in Premiere or DaVinci. From then on, you're working in those. And so anytime you iterate a shot, you'll re-render it out, replace it in the edit. I didn't start doing any actual animation in Maya really until I had the edit locked. And I mean, locked. Mike was already working on the audio. He's working on the score. Like, it was locked. And I rendered it with 8 frame handles on either side and I animated it. And then when I got a note from a friend and he said, I think you're cutting a bit faster at this point here. Yeah. And I'm like, no, I can do about that now. I ain't got enough frames to open it up. So it's done. Like, it's, you know.
What would your advice be, particularly given your experience in working in previz, should we then assemble and edit as quickly as possible and use that as the center for everything? Is that the thing we need to keep coming back to all the time?
If I think you mean what I think you mean, are you describing the idea of creating the entire action that you can then drop cameras into, and then because you've got the entire action laid out, like for example an explosion going off, it will always go off at the same time, is that what you mean?
If the whole thing plays out and then you can
my advice would be don't do that.
Right, okay, why not? Why?
Because that's not how films are made. Like, they don't do that on set. You know, you have a, for me, I have an idea of what I want in a shot, and if it means I've got to move the truck to where it's not supposed to be just to get the shot, as long as it doesn't jump out in the edit, I'm perfectly fine with that. That's literally how they make films. Like, my first question to my supervisor when I started on Jurassic World was exactly that. I said, do you do that? You can do what I just described in Unreal, but you can do it in Maya as well. Because that's how I'd been doing stuff. And he said, no, absolutely not. That's not how I want to do it. They don't do that on set. You know, they've got an idea if they want this shot of this character doing this, and they get that, and then they'll set up for the next shot, and each shot's a setup. So I might reuse setups multiple times, but as soon as I can, I want that to be a standalone piece of action, because I might want to go, actually, that explosion is going to look better if I move it here. But if I move it there in this shot to make that shot look better, it's now broken 5 other shots.
So this is really helpful for another reason for me, which is I wrote a thing that was like 30 seconds long just for the sake of doing something in Unreal that was like, would have felt like a teaser. And then I've met these two actors, and the more read-throughs we were doing, the more it was expanding. And I was like, let me just re-add a thing, because I think we need to flesh out this character. And now it's I think the script is like 11 pages, but I was thinking with that one it will just be two metahumans kind of walking through the ship, and then I'll put the cameras where they need to be. But the suggestion from you sounds like with that film and with the group one we're doing, the better thing to do would be think about it as the beat or the shot level, and then work in Unreal, work in like in layers or something, and just have each layer,
each shot is a level sequence.
As a level sequence.
Yeah. But so I don't want to be too literal about what I'm saying. So my first point of call, I'll put as much of the action together as is feasible.
Right.
So, but I just won't break my back to do it. Like, if it's going to be a pain to get this bit of animation tied onto this bit, well, if there's a cut there, I can already see where there's going to be a cut anyway in my head. And you'd have it on the storyboards, then don't bother. Just start a new bit of action. And so, it's like you might have, I'm trying to think of a,
Right. No, that Jurassic, one of your previs for Jurassic World, for example, where it comes, there's a dinosaur that bursts out, runs past him, and it bursts out of that sort of like a cell.
The prison, yeah.
And it knocks its head on the thing. Yeah. So we have to see it from inside, and then there's that sense of action as it impacts the door, and the door comes up a bit, and then it hits its head. And I think there's two or three cuts in that.
Mm-hmm.
But so is that sequence where would you have redone? So
the animation of Owen jumping up, grabbing the bars in that shot is this completely separate bit of animation to Owen walking out of the thing two shots later. The Stygimoloch probably was one piece of animation bursting out, and you get as far as the bar, but then I knew that I had to animate that separately from a different angle. So I animated it from the camera angle, roughly the camera angle that I was expecting it would go from. This is two shots and it's two completely separate bits of action.
You've rebuilt the set completely, or you've used it in...
No, so the set would be the same because it comes from a separate asset, but the action itself, my action, I mean the dinosaur and Owen and the door and all the other stuff will be...
So this is one shot here, and then you've...
Yeah. That's the bit of the film, the cutaway, and then this is a separate bit.
So you've worked on them kind of separately. It's not the case. And this is my thought, is the advantage.
Took half an hour, like.
Right. Because the advantage, the temptation is to actually make a sequence where the dinosaur's bursting through the door and then I stick a camera here and I cut it. But it's just not... When is that a good idea and when is it not a good idea?
In Prazinburk Ridge, like when they're having a conversation in the truck, let me get it right. Did I do this? It was a couple of years ago. I recorded the dialogue, I think, myself, doing both actors. Then I put the mocap suit on and I acted out my dialogue. I mean, I didn't just do it randomly each time. I acted out the dialogue because I'd got the dialogue together so I could respond. And I recorded those and I put those in to the truck and the truck go along the path. And then every shot uses that as a base. But if I need to move all the action, or if I need to tweak any animation, things like that, then I'm doing it on a, I'll do it on a shot by shot basis. And when I came to do the final bit of polish and lip sync, each single individual shot gets exported each time. So I animate just to the camera that it's designed to be seen from, just for those amount of frames.
So that when he cleans his goggles, for example, which is a lovely shot because he takes the mask off, because, you know, bloody mask, takes it off, starts to wipe it with his finger, and then you cut down. It's, you know,
we're attached to the goggles.
Again, you made it and you thought, I wonder what it's like if I just whip a camera down there, or you had that shot in mind?
No, that was one of the problem shots I had earlier this year when I came back to it. I never quite could make it work because it was going to involve... I'll tell you, this is a way of getting around something. If I had a shot of him holding the mask and cleaning the lens, it was going to involve some cloth sim because that mask is cloth and it's going to be hanging there.
Right.
And I was like, I really don't want to be.
Yeah.
So I had a shot of his hands cleaning it, but I couldn't, it, I was going to be, there's a lot of tactile features about that shot that was going to be a problem. And I was never really happy with it. And then I had the idea of doing it. I think I've been watching Better Call Saul, you know, and there's a lot of those cameras attached to things.
It is very much like
up
that.
On cranes and intact.
I'd been watching that and I just thought it'd be cool for him to wipe away, to see us to wipe away the thing. Because also the problem is trying to get across the idea that he's struggling to see. And if we can't, so we've got one shot of him seeing what he can see.
Yeah.
But I just thought it'd be nice to be able to see through the lens and actually see him clean it and then see the difference in what he's done, you know.
That's thoughtful.
It is very thoughtful. I love the fact that you got that from something like Better Call Saul, because there's these nice close-ups. So we got the German point of view through the thing. We see what he sees, and now there's this sense of, you know,
he's got clear vision.
Yeah,
yeah.
And he just needs to clean that off. But you get this nice, you know, extreme close-up, and then we pull back out to this. I don't know why that was such a striking moment in there, but it completely fits. It's sort of, it's out of place, but it's completely in place.
Yeah. It's the juxtaposition of the lens as well. That's a long lens on the close up and then really wide on the mask. So it's, you're getting that kind of...
Yeah.
And this, I know texture. This is going to sound weird, but that's one of my favorite shots in the whole thing. Like the cutaway, the fact that you cut away from here to black, essentially, which makes sense as the mask goes on. There's a sudden sort of blackness, which makes sense with the mask. And I've just... this shot of just pulling this out, again, this was like the match cut. This was when I needed to know who you were, because I was like, who the who made this? Because this is not, these are not accidental shots. These are,
no.
This is someone who understood this shot is, this is exactly the shot that's going to work. Yeah, I think that's great. So just to kind of wrap it up, we've taken up a lot of your time, Martin, but any sort of, what should we be doing next? Where should we be focusing? And
what haven't we considered?
Yeah, what haven't we considered?
I think certainly, obviously, making sure the story. I think the most important thing, I get comments about Prazinburk Ridge, about it was reviewed on a thing called Completely Machinima, and they'd already reviewed a film that was on Short of the Week, right. And I got rejected from Short of the Week. And they said that they got lost in the film that was on Short of the Week quite a lot. They weren't sure where they were at times. And they commented about that on Prazinburk Ridge, saying there's not a single point in the film where I don't know where I am or don't know what's going on. That wasn't always the case.
Right.
I've test screened this extensively, right. Amongst friends and amongst film friends and amongst friends who aren't film. And tell me honestly, do you understand what's going on here? And as I said, even to the point where just a couple of weeks before, I got a comment about not knowing what was going on. And I'm like, right, well, I've not gone far enough then in it, making sure that the characters are explaining without being overly expository exactly where the danger is and what it is they're trying to achieve. I would just test it over and over, a new set of eyes.
Yeah.
So don't exhaust it all at the same time.
Yeah.
And then the first group of people you show it to should be film people who are going to be able to give you really good constructive, because non-film people might be able to tell you that they got lost, but they might not have a solution. But film people tend to do, so they'll at least have some suggestions that you things you might try. So as you get in, as you go on, expand that field of people who you're asking for input out into effectively then into finally into layman's. Ask your mum last.
Yeah, yeah. You know, right.
Well, they might see something that the film people
that's
might
exactly
not.
Yeah, so you still need their input, but they're gonna. You don't want to be doing is trying to fix things that they should just write at the start, because there might be bigger things that are just not that they're.
Makes sense.
Yeah, because quite a lot of times, like I'll if we're watching something and I think there's been like a weird. I watched this one the other day and there's a really weird cut. I can't remember what it was. Really weird cut. And I was like, well, that was weird. And I look around at the wife and it's not
registered it at all.
Not registered at all. Yeah. No, that's fine then, right? If it doesn't, it's only me seeing, I'm overly sensitive to these things.
For you, the rest of the film was completely ruined because you're trying to figure out why that happened.
But yeah, I think do that. And the other thing to avoid, in fact, it's funny you mentioned it about the first minute, and it's by design in the first minute of the film. Where there's a lot of shots, there's quite a lot of establishes, and it's intentionally designed to be peaceful and slow, because when we get to the, after the first transition, we're going to go to the battlefield where things are much louder and hectic and cuttier. But one of the things that I struggled with here is making sure that there's enough story in these shots to justify their existence.
Yeah.
Because what you get a lot of time with, especially in Unreal, you can get the beautiful, gorgeous environment for next to nothing on the environment on the marketplace, and then stick a camera in it and call it a film, and it's not. A film has to have a story, and
I love the pacing. I thought it was
and it's by design, but it is encroaching on what I would consider like there's too. The shots are too long and there's not enough going on. It doesn't quite, I mean, I was quite intentional as to what I'm doing, but what I find in a lot of people's work, especially the real-time filmmakers working in Unreal, it's very easy to just let your camera, just let your edit run on and on and on.
Yeah.
And you know, unless there's story there. So
guitar solos are great, but not 10 minutes of just a guitar solo.
Exactly.
You know,
exactly that. Yeah. That's one of those things where it's just because you can generate the imagery really cheaply doesn't mean you should.
I think the last question is, we're kind of going the other way from you. You went into the industry and then you learned what you needed to learn to make something for yourself. One of the big reasons we're doing this is kind of almost like a calling card to say, you know, we wanted to prove that because we're all looking for sort of jobs afterwards. I don't think people normally do it this way, but you know, what are our chances? You know,
never tell me the odds.
No. I mean, just the way the industry is going. I mean, it's, if you make something and it should be able to get you work if it's good, like it's, you know, and that includes, I mean, you know, environment work, Fred, like things like that, like the people are in demand everywhere. So it's like, you need a portfolio and
that's it.
You're in, yeah, I would say.
So this is, I mean, this, we're trying to make this as, yeah, we're trying to explore some stuff. The AI thing we're exploring is, you know, is an interesting one. How do we build that into the workflow? That's not a thing that's been done, but it's certainly something that's sped up large parts of this film. We're often surprised, and Fred's just, I guess, sort of prompt engineering. And now we're looking at, well, what if we take something out of Midjourney, put it into DALL-E and take that out of there and put it into Stable Diffusion? Then, you know, what's the ideal way to get this close to?
I see the use of Midjourney is like making paint. It's like you make art with paint,
yeah,
but you need to make paint first. And this is just us making paint.
Yeah.
And it's like, oh, okay, you know, I don't think it's like you can consider it just art on its own. It's just the fact that we're doing so much with it.
I think you can generate, definitely. I think that's a good way of thinking about it, a good way of describing it as well. I have used it a little bit, I was tinkering more than anything, but yeah.
Because it's interesting. I mean, it's never been done before.
Yeah.
That's the really cool thing. It's suddenly so powerful. Mm. And yeah, when I was a kid, I knew that technology was going to get better, but I never knew it would be this good.
Yeah, and getting exponentially better every day as well.
I know. I mean, what if this is like the future of food? I just ask an engine, like, make me a tasty strawberry pizza and it will just do it.
Earl Grey hot. Yeah. Shut up, Wesley. listen, Martin, thank you very much. I'll put you on the spot and say, can you be one of the people that we can, be our film savvy people that we could send this to say, where are we going wrong?
No, of course, absolutely.
Thank you, man.